Thanks for joining us again here at the Azure Academy. Today, we're talking about Windows Virtual Desktop and how to create a disaster recovery strategy that's going to work for you. So come and join us because we're starting right now.
I'm Dean Cifola, and this is the Azure Academy.
If you want to master the Azure Cloud, you can start right now by clicking the subscribe button and the notification bell so you don't miss anything.
So when thinking about disaster recovery planning, no matter what the application is, and WVD in this case is the application, there are a few different things that you need to think about. Identifying your risk, assessing vulnerabilities, determining the level of impact, and then identifying critical business services, designing mitigation for those services, having some kind of plan to start the process and activate everything, testing, and then continuous improvement. WVD and disaster recovery can have multiple different ways of implementing it, depending on what's important to you. So we're gonna take a look at three different aspects of WVD disaster recovery, and that would be our virtual machines, our user identities, and our storage profile data. There is also a new doc on DR planning for WVD that I did help to write, and that's over in the Azure Docs, link down in the description below. While you're down there, maybe consider clicking the subscribe button and the like button, notification bell, all that, so you can stay in touch with what's going on. And that really does help us out as well, and we appreciate that. ASR is the Azure Site Recovery Service. This is the native disaster recovery service to Azure, and it is the way that we can pick up your VMs and replicate them to another region, and could very well be the right solution for you with WVD. It shines best in a personal host pool scenario where I care about the data on the virtual machine, and I need to keep that data on that VM safe because it's somebody's personal computer. So in our host pool, we go to session host, I've got two virtual machines that I want to protect with Azure Site Recovery. So over here on the very sidebar, I've got pinned the Recovery Services Vault, and this is where Azure Site Recovery lives. And we'll go ahead and create a new Recovery Services Vault. So I'll create a new resource group for this, and I'll call this WVD-ASR and store it in the West US region. So we'll hit next, and I'll add some tags, and then we'll create. And in the new Recovery Services Vault at the top, we'll click to enable site recovery. And then for virtual machines, we'll click to enable replication. This is going from the source of East US using the Azure Resource Manager model as opposed to Classic. And I'll select my subscription and my resource group where the VMs live. My systems are not in an availability zone, so if yours are, then you would select yes here and then select which zone you are using. And I'll hit next. And here we have my VMs. So I'll protect these two, which are part of that personal host pool, and then hit next. And our target location is the West US. We'll have a new resource group called WVD-DR-ASR, as well as a -ASR virtual network, a new storage account to handle all our replication, as well as a new availability set. And it's that simple. You can just hit replication and ASR will start protecting your stuff. One of the main conversations that happens around disaster recovery is RPO and RTO, the recovery point and recovery time objectives. Now, in the recovery point, we're talking about how much data you can afford to lose in the event of a disaster. And the recovery time is about how long it takes to get back up and running. So for our recovery point objective, we've selected in our recovery policy that we can go up to 4 hours. In our recovery time, well, this is where ASR really shines because the time is as long as we want it to be. The very fastest that you could possibly go is how long it takes you to turn on a virtual machine. The longest that it can go will depend on how you customize your recovery plan. So you could have multiple steps, including manual steps as part of that, but understand that one of the other things that you need to make ASR work is you need connectivity back to those file servers, domain controllers, DNS, maybe firewalls, and other centralized services, which will now have to be available in your primary and your secondary disaster recovery region. So the second thing that we were going to talk about was the identity of our users. Where do we store them? In our DR region, we need some access of some kind to Active Directory. This could be because you have a domain controller that's staged permanently in your DR region, or you're going to peer back to your primary East US region or on-premise over your VPN or express route. Any of those scenarios work, including ASR protecting your domain controller. If you have just like a single domain controller, that obviously works as well. Wherever it is, just keep in mind that Azure AD Connect still has to be involved, and it has to be syncing your identities into Azure so that you can make use of them within WVD. Let's move on to scenario number two, where things are a little bit different. So you can most certainly use a ASR for your pooled host pools. If you want to use that same DR management solution, it will totally work. However, your pooled host pools is not something that you really need to protect because there's no actual data on the virtual machines. That's one of the benefits of a pooled VM. It doesn't matter which VM you land on, they're all configured exactly the same way. The VM could be considered more of a throwaway type device. And we'll talk a little bit more about this when we talk about our storage protection in just a minute. Pooled host pool here, that's the in-place host pool. I want to click on that for a second. And I have four session hosts in this pool. So if I click on my session host, you can see two of them are unavailable and their drain mode is set to on. Now notice where they are located. In the West US, in my DR region. Now, in order to make this work seamlessly, there's a few things to keep in mind. One is you still need connectivity back to your domain controllers. We also need your image to be in both regions, and we'll talk more about that in a minute. But the VMs don't all have to live in the same region. Just be aware that if you have them all powered on, that your users will log on to whichever one is available. So if you have users who are in East US, they might end up running on a VM in West US. And that would obviously not be ideal. But there is one other thing to consider. That is the blast radius of your disaster. Taking a look at all the host pools once again, we have our third host pool, and that is your DR region host pool. And notice that this is located in the West US. And we take a look at our session host, it is also in the West US. So this is an entirely separate implementation of a host pool running in West US. Reason why we would do this approach is if you need to be fully up and running and manageable in the case of the East US completely going dark. Azure is constructed by APIs, and the top level API that controls everything is the ARM API, Azure Resource Manager. Now, thankfully, as far as I remember, this has never happened, but if it ever did, whatever's in the East US would be unmanageable, which is part of the reason why Azure Site Recovery is stored in the DR region, so that it can still manage everything even if East US went down. So if you need to protect against that level of disaster, then you should have a host pool somewhere else in the world. So let's move on to the third topic, and that would be our profile and storage data. When thinking about our storage, we have our FSLogix profiles, our app attach files, and our images. Now, if you're not using MSIX App Attach yet, no worries. All that stuff is probably in your image anyway. For your images, we can store those in Azure as an Azure managed image, or we could store them in the shared image gallery, which lets us very easily replicate them to any region in the world and then manage them from one place. And if you missed our video on the shared image gallery, it's right up there. Go take a look. For MSIX App Attach and our FSLogix profiles, we have some other options that I'm sure you're familiar with. You can use a Storage Spaces Direct VM in Azure, or you could use Azure Files Standard or Premium, depending on your performance needs, or Azure NetApp Files. Now, each one of them has a different replication strategy and DR procedure. For example, NetApp Files has the ability to do the snap mirror type replication between two different NetApp appliances. And if you're interested in a video on that, give me some comments down below, and I'll be happy to create a video on that for you. For Azure Files, Standard and Premium, there's two different things to consider. Azure Files Standard is able to do normal Azure Files replication between region to region using GRS or RAGRS and between zones with ZRS. However, GRS is not a viable option in Azure Premium today. ZRS, however, is, but you're still within the same region. So if you need to go from region to region, cross country, or wherever it is that your DR is, keep that in mind. There is another option, and that is FSLogic's Cloud Cache. Cloud Cache can take care of replicating from whatever storage you have over here to whatever storage you want over there, and it doesn't matter what the underlying storage is. There are some downsides to using Cloud Cache, though, and that is when your users are logging in on a daily basis, the logon experience for Cloud Cache is a few seconds longer because it has to make connectivity to all your replication points. And then there is the OS disk itself where FSLogix is installed. That disk needs to be performant enough to be able to take care of all of the users you have on that disk writing to it. Now, switching between the BHD locations and the Cloud Cache settings, which are the CCD locations, is very, very simple to do. Even simpler if you're using group policy like we are right over here. In our group policy, we'll right click on our GPO and we'll go to edit. So under computer configuration, we'll go to policies, admin templates, and then FSLogix. And under here, you can see a Cloud Cache folder, but we're not going to go into that just yet because we need to first disable the default BHD locations and change it over to the Cloud Cache mode. So click on the profile containers and then take the BHD locations, copy the path, and then hit disable on that. And then in here, notice that there is another subfolder for Cloud Cache, which we're going to open. Go to the Cloud Cache locations, and then we want to change this to enabled. And now we need to use the same path. However, we have to form this string in a different manner. Type equals SMB comma connection string equals full path to the file share. And then for your next path, it's semicolon and then repeat. Type equals SMB comma connection string equals path to the next file share. And you can have up to, I believe it is 4 different file shares that you are replicating your data to. Keep in mind, however, that the more items you add, the more connections that Cloud Cache will have to establish and validate and then keep in sync, which all runs off the processor of your local virtual machine. And that goes for your operating system disk as well to have enough IOPS to be able to write all the local cache and handle all of that replication goodness. Now, at a very basic minimum setup, that's all you need to do to enable Cloud Cache. There are several other settings that we can get into in a deeper video on FSLogix. And if you're interested in that, comment down below and I'll get to work on creating that for you. So thanks for joining me for a look at Windows Virtual Desktop Disaster Recovery Planning. And we did not get into every little detail and specific scenario that you could ever run into in all of your organizations because they are literally infinite. So take these principles along with the doc, which is in the video description below, so that you can start planning what is right for you in your DR setup or WVD. So I hope that you're subscribed to the Azure Academy. If not, hit that big red button and the thumbs up and the notification bell and all of that stuff because there is always more to come on the Azure Academy. I want to hear from you. So tell me down below in the comments what you're interested in, what videos we can make for you going forward. And over on the top right, you can find our latest video and over on the bottom right, another video that the masters over at YouTube have picked out just for you to help you to keep learning about Azure. Thanks very much for joining us today and we will catch you next time. Happy learning.